through what syncretism the attic is at once small and large, warm and cool, always comforting. Section 3. This being the case, we shall have to introduce a slight nuance at the very base. I pointed out earlier that the unconscious is housed. It should be added that it is well and happily housed, and in the space of its happiness. The normal unconscious knows how to make itself at home, else everywhere, and psychoanalysis comes to the assistance of the ousted unconscious, of the unconscious that has been set roughly or insidiously dislodged. But psychoanalysis sets the human being in motion rather than at rest. It calls on him to live outside the abodes of his unconscious, to enter into life's adventures, to come out of himself, to enter into life's adventures. Naturally, its action is a salutary one, because we must also give an exterior destiny to the interior being. To accompany psychoanalysis in this salutary action, we shall have to undertake a topoanalysis of all the space that has invited us to come out of ourselves. In French, carry me along. Roads, wrote Marcel de Bourvamont, recalling her native Flanders. And what a dynamic, handsome object is a path. How precise the familiar hill paths remain for our muscular consciousness. You walk the same path. You don't have to look down. You know where all the roots are, the stones. You can do it in the dark. A poet has expressed dynamism in a single line. Jean Colbert. Oh, my roads and their cadence. When I relive dynamically the road that climbed that hill, I am quite sure that the road itself had muscles, or rather counter muscles. In my room in Paris, it is a good exercise for me to think of the road in this way. As I write this page, I feel freed of my duty to take a walk. I am sure of having gone out of my house. And indeed, we should find countless intermediaries between reality and symbols if we gave things all the movements they suggest. George Sand, dreaming beside a path of yellow sand, saw a life floating by. What is more beautiful than a road, she wrote. It is the symbol and the image of an active, varied life. Each one of us, then, should speak of his roads, his crossroads, his roadside benches. Each one of us should make a surveyor's map of the lost fields and meadows. Thoreau said that he had the map of his fields engraved in his soul. And Jean Wall once wrote, we're going to underline this passage like this. Each one of us should speak of his crossroads. Jean Wall wrote, the frothing of the hedges I keep deep inside me. Thus, we cover the universe with drawings we have lived. These drawings need not be exact. They need only to be tonalized on the mode of our inner space. But what a book would have to be written to decide all these problems. Space calls for action, and before action, the imagination is at work. It mows and plows. We should have to speak of the benefits of all these imaginary actions. psychoanalysis has made numerous observations on the subject of projective behavior, on the willingness of extroverted persons to exteriorize their intimate impressions. An exteriorist typoanalysis would perhaps give an added precision to this projective behavior by defining our daydreams of objects. However, in this present work, I shall not be able to undertake, as should be done, the twofold imaginary geometrical and physical problem of extroversion and introversion. Moreover, I do not believe that these two branches of physics have the same psychic weight. My research is devoted to the intimacy, to the domain of intimacy, to the domain in which psychic weight is dominant. I shall therefore put my trust in the power of attraction of all the domains of intimacy. There does not exist a real intimacy that is repellent. All the spaces of intimacy are designated by an attraction. Their being is well-being. In these conditions, topoanalysis bears the stamp of a topophilia, and shelters and rooms will be studied in the sense of the